Call the meeting to order at 6:05. South County EMS meeting for September 27, 2018.
Good start.
Entertain a motion of the minutes from 2 months ago.
Motion.
Second.
Discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Zach report?
The Zach report. Can't spell union news or something. We'll fix it later. Great. Okay. So it's been a couple of months.
Yeah, big report.
Yeah. I know, sometimes I gotta, you know, hunt for things to say and other times I have to. So we'll buzz through it. We've been talking about community paramedicine for quite some time. A lot of dragging of the feet by the state, and then all of a sudden, they announced their plan. And it's a three-tier plan. The lowest, I shouldn't say lowest, but the first tier is what they're referring to as community EMS. And this is basically what we're doing now. This is the blood pressure clinics, the reaching out, the fall risk assessments that we're doing already, those types of things. It is a separate, like, licensing program, but it's free of charge, as long as your local Board of Health is a co-signatory on it, co-signer on it. So just what they're really looking for is to close that gap with the Boards of Health and the local EMS services and making sure everybody's on the same page. So this is really exciting. This is something that won't cost us anymore and will open up more avenues for us and really be able to coalesce what we're actually doing. The other two tiers is called Mobile Integrated Healthcare, or MIH. And this is a very steep licensing fee. This is $7,000, $15,000. And the idea is that this will actually originate at the hospital level or at the healthcare organization level. Nowadays, after the Affordable Care Act, if we take somebody to the emergency room and they get readmitted for something that they're already seen in the hospital for, the hospital can no longer bill insurance for that readmission. The Affordable Care Act says you own that patient, you should have been providing them with care already. So because they can't bill for it, there's a financial incentive for them to create these mobile integrated health systems. So a $7,000 licensing fee is a drop in the bucket compared to what it would cost them to treat these patients for free. So we're gonna expect to see that kind of roll out in Eastern Mass first. There are some large ambulance services that are actually run by healthcare organizations, so we'll probably see it there, and then we'll see it in the hospital-based systems. This is so brand new. The webinars just came out not even a few weeks ago, so I haven't even had an opportunity to have a discussion with Bay State Health, which is our affiliate hospital and our medical control.
Yeah.
And I'm not even sure they know what that's gonna look like yet. So it's still too new to know whether we're gonna be participating in any sort of mobile integrated healthcare, but the community EMS stuff we can do immediately once that system comes up. There's obviously going to be like an investment by South County EMS to continue doing it, but it's going to be what we're already doing. It's going to be that impact shift, doing those outreach programs and things like that. The mobile integrated healthcare, they have requirements for equipment and training and things. So, but with the community EMS, it should be a very easy buy-in for us. So it's good. Call volume is remaining up. I printed out, this is actually every year our call runs. It's broken down by location and mutual aid. But like the far leftmost column is our calls by year. And just glancing over it, you can see that it keeps going up.
Since inception.
Yes, yeah. Okay. And this past August marked the fourth consecutive month we treated over 100 patients. Before it was kind of a trickle here and there, and it's going up. We normally see a downturn in calls through the winter months, just less people being active and traveling and things like that. But I think that we can pretty much rest assured that we're gonna continue to see that call volume go up. We had a 10% increase every year since inception, and it almost seems exponential at this point.
Even January was 113.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
It was 80s last year.
I didn't spend too much time, you know, breaking it out, but is it
all just calls for the three communities or the calls for your transfers or whatever?
Yeah, primarily it's just our communities.
Okay.
We had a fluke month, what was it? August, we had a massive number of intercepts, more than we've ever had. I think that's gonna be a fluke. You know, I expect that to be unusual. But the reality is, with Medcare Health in Greenfield, you know, them being a for-profit organization, always trying to cut trucks, and then just our neighboring communities suffering from the same thing we were before we created South County EMS, the lack of volunteers and things like that. I think, you know, we're going to continue to see this demand, and there's been a lot of times where we are the only paramedics available when somebody needs advanced life support in this section of the county. So it's really us and Coleraine and occasionally Northfield, depending on what their staffing is. So it's going up. We do this is going to be a quick review for everybody listening probably, but our current staffing model is a paramedic ambulance 24/7, and that requires two providers at least being a paramedic. And then during our busiest hours, which we identify as 10 a.m. to 6 p.m., we add what we call an impact shift, which is one additional person that is in station, on duty, in uniform. So that additional person plus me during the weekdays, or from a local call staff member on the weekends or when I'm in a meeting or out of town, that gives us two staffed ambulances during our busiest times. And that works pretty well. The problem is that impact shift is staffed by our per diem staff, so it means that sometimes it goes unfilled. So we don't spend overtime in order to make sure that shift is filled. Sometimes it's just me, and we can still respond immediately and render aid immediately within those 7 minutes on average, but we're still waiting for a mutual aid truck to respond to actually transport. And looking back, you know, we do that 7 days a week, and on average, there might be one shift a week, sometimes two, that we don't have the impact shift filled. And that could be either a weekday or it could be a weekend. There's no consistency with that because a lot of our per diems are on rotating schedules elsewhere. And I mention this because we're in that funny spot where too many calls for one truck and currently too few calls for two. But with that trending going up, we need to at least consider the notion that we're probably going to have to do something about staffing, if not immediately, but down the line somewhere. And I don't know exactly what that looks like, whether it's adding 24/7 impact, that third person, or whether it's adding a second person during the day, so we have more bandwidth in case somebody can't make it or something like that. We should be thinking about that. I mean, even last night we had simultaneous calls at 1:30 in the morning. It's not typical, but it's a reality for our growing system. So,
as the calls go up, does the income or the revenue also increase as well?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you do that thing where you add staff and your expenses are up here, but now you're making more calls.
Sure.
And then you get to that point where you got to add another person. So you're kind of chasing yourself the whole time, but there is absolutely that. And, you know, our policy is that we do intercepts if it doesn't deplete our service down here.
Right.
So by adding that staff, we're more likely to be available for those intercepts and those guaranteed returns. A lot of our intercept agreements, the vast majority of them, are a flat fee. So it's not dependent on whether the person's insured or their ability to pay. If we intercept Greenfield, they cut us a check for $270 and we call it a day. So convenient and easy. Lori Lankowski, she's the recently appointed emergency manager for the town of Deerfield. She's a full-time firefighter paramedic in Amherst. I've known her. I went to the police academy, part-time police academy with her, and she works here at South County as a paramedic. She's hit the ground running, and she's recently applied for the emergency preparedness grant to get disaster supplies, bleeding control supplies. These are things that we carry enough on our ambulance for one patient. because that's typically how many critical patients we will have. And the police department carries it for themselves. But we have, if we ever have a major incident, either an act of violence or naturally occurring, we're going to need more supplies. So she identified that as a need in our community. She reached out to the other emergency managers and the other department heads, and it looks like we're going to be getting it.
We signed that last night.
Yeah.
She picked up the paperwork.
That's great. So that's a commitment from the state for the fund for the supplies.
Yep.
I've committed myself and South County EMS to conduct the training and the education. I'm a Stop the Bleed instructor now. We've actually got a course coming up in Sunderland next month. We're going to be doing the local police departments. I did some nurses at their disaster triage training recently, so we're going to keep doing that and roll that out. It's good. And then additionally, some South County EMS personnel will be attending a course, grant-funded course, in Belchertown next month. It's a three-day course, it's called an Officer Down Rescue. But it's basically responding to emergencies, acts of violence, how to keep yourself safe, how to treat patients of trauma. So just kind of that, a lot of our staff already have that. Now that's coming around again on the grant, we're getting some more people trained. So it'll be a good opportunity to increase what we can do. What's that?
Vehicles,
yeah. So here's the elephant in the room.
Can I go back for 1 second towards the... mutual aid. I was wondering, are we receiving mutual aid from other towns?
Yes.
Primarily Amherst, Northampton?
Correct. Yep.
So, and we know they have fully staffed paramedic level EMTs, but there's a neighbor to the north that I don't know if they have paramedic level paramedic level service.
Mm-hmm. Are we talking Medicare or?
No, I'm talking town, funded.
Yep.
Now, Bobby may be able to speak better to this, but I know like at one time, Amherst was going to charge us, $100,000 just because.
To be there.
To be there, to do their intercepts because we're doing a number. So I'm just wondering, if we're continually to do these intercepts, How do we, just because the residents of South County have taken, they're but bite the bullet to pay for this service, and others utilize it where they don't pay for paramedic level in their own communities.
Right.
I kind of have a little problem with that.
I agree with you.
Yeah. So they're paying on a per intercept basis, and through our intercept agreement.
But the town's not. The town or city's not. The person is.
Sure. If the fee is passed on, yeah.
We're not getting anything additional from the town. No.
Right. Correct. Our agreement, that's how we get paid through the agreement, and our agreement allows us to say we're not available for an intercept. So it's feasible. It's feasible that we could re-sign an agreement with them that says we will provide you with these intercepts on these conditions, and it might be,
I'm just thinking. I know it's tough, but at the same time, we're investing a lot of resources into making this happen, and we're very fortunate that our three towns have got together and looked ahead and found this as a need, but. That being said, it'd be nice, even if we could get $5,000, and say, hey, this is a retainer, and because not every call that you go on, every intercept you go on, you're getting reimbursed for it because insurance may not pay, and or they may pay at a reduced rate.
Yep.
So I could understand it, if Amherst needs if Amherst needs South County, well, Amherst residents have stepped up and they're paying for a paramedic level. If Northampton needs a service, they're paying for a paramedic level service. Well, some of our neighbors to the north, they're not. They're not paying anything, not even basic EMT. They're not paying even basic EMTs. So
they're getting a benefit without paying for it.
Sort of. And again, I know it's a hard thing to discuss, but we shouldn't be afraid to.
Yeah, right.
And maybe they understand that. Mm-hmm. You know, and maybe there's something that we can work out with them.
Yeah.
You know, and say, hey, look, but you know, or just say, hey, look, if we don't get 100% reimbursement, can we bill you?
Yeah.
You know, so we charge them $2,000 and the insurance pays us $500.
Right.
And we know what it costs to run an ambulance system.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Right, Mr. Finance Committee person? I mean, we know. So why wouldn't we be able to collect that other $1,500 from the place that's not putting forward any money to support a paramedic level service? I don't know, just something. Yeah. I just wanted to put that out there. I know it may seem draconian, but at the same time, if we still want to provide this service for our residents, you know, we have to look at all the costs that we incur.
Right.
And that's a business, and that's unfortunately that's a business side of the medicine right now.
Right.
So, Zach, what do we get charged if we have to call in, or if you have to call in service to that?
It varies by agreement, but it's typically between the $250, $275 range if it's a flat fee. Or it could be that we bill the patient directly for specifically what we did, and then the other service bills for the BLS level stuff. That's a little bit more clunky, and the patient gets two bills. I like the flat fee, it's easy math and easy billing.
Particularly if you can bill the town.
Yeah, well, right, so there's pros and cons. That $275 is billed to the town. So pros and cons for both, and it depends on the service.
And that fee hasn't changed in 10 years either.
That's been
in that same area for a long time.
You know, and can you just look at it?
Yeah, look at the agreement.
Yeah, yeah.
And maybe there's no room, we don't have any room, but it'd be nice to look at.
Right.
Some people talk about it. Franklin County EMS meeting.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and you know, and even at $275, it's not a lot, but that covers like one paramedic overtime 8 hours.
Yeah.
You know, so it's like when you think about it in that terms, you know, it's a nice. Ugh, I hate talking about medicine's way, but the business, it's a nice return on investment that if, you know, if we're already invested in the equipment and the vehicles, you know, if we spend a little bit of money to put that staff on, then, no, and we know we're going to do the intercepts, that's the other part of that component.
Right.
Wasn't too long ago that we were in that situation where we were calling them quite a bit to cover our costs.
Absolutely.
But
you're right,
we're putting the money out now to fix our problem. And we're servicing out of our service area.
And again, the only reason I mention it is because Zach is talking about personnel and equipment, you know, and those are costs that we're bearing. You know, those are borne by the three towns.
Yeah.
And again, you may get the $275 covers an 8 hours overtime, but is that person just coming in for that one run and then going home if you call them in, or are they staying here? You know, wear and tear on the vehicle.
Yeah, right.
I don't know. And again, that's just. And again, it's a cost. It's you have when you run a business. We are. You have to look at those things.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good point. What else you got there, Zach?
The increased demands on our system not only stress our staffing but our equipment as well. That's how I started that section. Between our call volumes increasing and additional community initiatives, the stress on our equipment and vehicles is greater than they were ever under the three separate EMS departments. So I mention this because now that we're doing so many more runs and we've got full-time staff, it's more than just, you know, the sum of its parts, the three departments before. So our frontline ambulance has been averaging about $25,000 25,000 miles a year.
Mm-hmm.
And that's just usage, transporting, responding.
That we've had that 1 year, right?
Yeah, but going back, when it was the other truck, it was right around 25,000 miles. Yeah. Our second line vehicle is less than half that, 10,000 miles a year, and our third line truck is 3,000. And that's consistent over those years. So our newest ambulance is the 2017 Ford.
Mm-hmm.
And when we designed that, it was built around crew and patient safety. So that operates as a frontline vehicle. We haven't had any mechanical concerns with that thing. It's worked very well for us. And it's one of the reasons they picked the Ford chassis is we have a good relationship with Ford at Greenfield.
Yep.
And when it needs preventive maintenance, oil changes, or repairs, it's very easy to shuttle up. Usually we'll incorporate it with a run to the hospital for drugs or something. We'll just go two up, drop it off, and pick it up, and when it's ready, it's back in service within a few minutes. Our second newest ambulance is the 2010 International, and that was the Deerfield truck, and it was appropriate choice at the time when we purchased that. The other options just couldn't match what this was, but that 25,000 miles a year that it had been driven, and now just the 10,000 miles, now it's proven to be unreliable under the increased emergency response workload. So it's got over 135,000 miles on it. I checked it today. And all the preventive maintenance and repairs have to be conducted by a heavy truck repair. And we've gone through various places and we finally settled on Nutmeg in West Springfield. They're the closest place that consistently does work that we're happy with. But the problem is the logistical problem. So shuttling, getting the truck down there, and then we'll have to take a personal vehicle to pick that employee back up and bring it back. And then, heaven forbid, it breaks down and we need a tow. It's a heavy wrecker tow to West Springfield. And it's a pain in our rear and it's costing a lot of money. The maintenance and repair costs for that unit in FY17 were almost $17,000. And that's an order of magnitude more than the other two trucks combined.
And that was for about 10,000 miles?
No, in 17, so that was, yeah, that was
the end of its full-time service.
Yeah, exactly. So that's right when we took it out of frontline service. The FY18, we saw a significant drop just moving it to second line service, but we're still like almost $10,000 a year on that truck, just keeping it running. And then the headache is, it does okay if you can start it and warm it and it comes up to temperature and you drive it to an event or something like that. It's the responding, that 0 to 60 type thing, where it really starts failing. And we had an incident in August where on the way to an emergency call, it broke down and we had to call for mutual aid immediately during our response. It didn't affect patient outcome. We had local responders and trained people on scene already. And we got another nearby paramedic truck to respond, but...
Yeah, can I talk about that? We don't have to talk, but can we come back to that, Bobby?
Yep.
Later?
Okay. Yeah.
Thank you.
About that incident or about the truck?
No, not the... Well, the truck I talk about now, but the response. I'd like to talk about the response when we have equipment failure and the procedures after that.
Okay. And then, so that's our International. And then our oldest ambulance is the 2007 Ford. And so that also receives preventive maintenance up at Greenfield, which is convenient. And it actually has pretty low miles. It's only like 30,000 miles on that for its age. But hard starts, lack of power, and the safety equipment and the layout is nearing a decade, or is a decade old at this point. So we use that for the community outreach, the kids climbing around it. It works really great for that. And same thing, we don't press it into emergency response work unless absolutely necessary. So it's actually proven itself very reliable in that role. When we first took it, we had to replace a turbo on that. And so that was kind of a big pill to swallow initially, but it's been good and reliable since then. So all of those three vehicles, those three ambulances, are the entirety of our fleet. So they're licensed and expected to provide transporting ambulance services. So we don't have any ability otherwise for our agency to transport additional or specialized equipment for planned or unplanned events. So when we did the Sutherland 300, we had to use personal vehicles to get the tents and things like that. Additionally, our department has no ability to blah, 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 blah. Oh, yes. We don't have any ability to move equipment from distant hospitals. So when we have backboards at Bay State, I drive my Jeep down to pick up the backboards, come back, and just things like garbage here. We don't have a way of getting our garbage to the transfer station. I'm not going to put our garbage in the back of a transporting ambulance.
Right.
So the highway department has been very gracious. They come by and actually pick up our garbage every week. South Deerfield Fire, when they make a run, they bring it up in their pickup truck. So those aren't critical problems,
right.
But it goes to show that we're having to source these solutions elsewhere. So that segues into our ambulance replacement schedule. We are scheduled for the next replacement in FY 2021. So it's FY 19 now, so another 2 years. The build times on the ambulances are now nearing about a full year. Colerain is specing one now, and that's what they were quoted. And the long-term concerns and the recent reliability concerns, it's my recommendation that we find the additional funds in the retained earnings and we move up that replacement from 2021 1 year to 2020. So we would basically, instead of doing our customary, whatever it is now, $57,000 or $60,000 a year, we would just do a double payment in fiscal year 20. And based on the estimations from the Deerfield Town Accountant, they haven't been certified yet, but with the retained earnings, we'll have enough money to do that and also still apply a similar amount, actually more, to offset the budget as we did for this fiscal year. So we wouldn't be biting into that in order to make this happen.
I would double check and see if she's got the retained earnings, because she had free cash a week ago, and it's, the process is the same.
Yeah, okay.
The 2017, was that a year early as well?
No.
No, that was right on schedule? This.
It was
a bit early.
And what truck would you replace? It
was a year early in the sense that we hadn't been in inception for 5 years but our oldest truck was a 2001.
Right.
It was beyond the 15 years that we were hoping to truck.
So, when you say a new truck, I mean, is the international body, can that be reused?
Well, that's where I was going to go.
So the quote on the rebuild, so moving the body over, they say saves about $20,000. And so you have to ask, is it worth it to save $20,000 if you're using the same old safety equipment and things like that, if you can find a chassis that fits?
I would assume we want the same type of chassis, which we may not want
this. So where I'm going with this is the International would be moved down to the third line service. So it would get 3,000 miles a year.
So the difference between 10,000 and 3,000 for it's not, no. It doesn't make sense to me.
That truck's been a problem ever since. I mean, not only that particular ambulance, but that whole line of international things, you know, they're just a problem child. And I would think that they could take that box and put it on a Ford chassis and we'd be a lot better off.
Potentially, you might have wheelbase issues and things and gas tank location issues where it might need some heavy modification. It's certainly worth looking.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
The idea is, though, if we do not get rid of a truck, if we can keep that Sunderland truck in service, we de-license it, we don't have those fees anymore, and now it's available for those equipment moves. Now the EMPG grant with the extra equipment can go on that truck, and we have a vehicle available to us that isn't dedicated to being a transporting ambulance, so we have options that we can use it for other events and things like that.
Can you use that to, I know if I go out to a football game or whatever, that's the vehicle I see, think.
Yep.
Can you still use it?
Yes.
There, okay.
Yes. The only difference is it wouldn't be licensed to transport, but so if its use is to bring just equipment and personnel to a location, use it for firefighter rehab, you get the stretcher out of there, now you can get firefighters and they can cool down or warm up inside of that vehicle or something like that.
The type of thing we were looking for.
The weight of the vehicle, we were talking about that one.
Right.
I would like to see you go through and do a complete analysis on keeping the box on the International and getting rid of the cab. And if it's not feasible, it's not feasible. But if it is, and you can save $100,000 out of a $275,000 expense, then you know that's a that's
well. What's all?
If you could.
What are the last ambulance costs?
The last ambulance cost $285,000, but $50,000 of that was the power load stretcher, the Knox box, things like that. Those would be transferred out of the ambulance. So the only equipment, and all the equipment on the ambulance would be moved over. The only equipment expense would be radios. So, you know, I think the ambulance itself costs $235, mm-hmm. right? So that's what it would cost to replace it.
But it's worth just look at it, and then you can sort of estimate that the old box has a limited life. I mean, it's not mm-hmm. it's not you're going to use that for 15 years.
Could any of that new, I mean, I know that safety power cotton all could go in, but could the harness stuff and the safety stuff that came in that new one also get in there? Or is it at that point it's just not worth it?
There's the reason that harness works is because the layout of the box puts everything within arm's reach.
Yep.
So
that was a really good system for sure. But, all right.
So I would say, like, to me, right now it's costing us $1.70 every time we roll out that one ambulance. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, I don't like spending $1.70 every, not including gas or fuel and everything else. I see where you're going with another vehicle for the location, but I can go buy a Chevy work truck through the county bid for $20,000 or the you know MHQ or whatever, and Zach, I'm sorry, but you guys can get by with vinyl seats and rubber floor mats, you know, and you could buy a truck for $23,000 versus keeping one of these other things, and you can put a cap on there and put a couple.
Well, you could buy one of them vans.
Or the dump though.
You could I just.
They talked about it.
I mean, I was looking at this as, you know, the trade-in for one of those ambulances is very little. So it's like, would it make more sense to just keep it and change its role than?
Well, I'm disappointed that the International, that's a 200,000+ mile mm-hmm. truck. I'm disappointed it gets 135,000.
Nobody's used it. Everybody's gotten rid of those. Yeah. They've been a disaster.
Well, I think if you're delivering beer, they work great. Because you warm it up, you do your truck check, and then you go, you know, 55 miles an hour.
There was going to be the answer back in the day.
Business. Yeah. But, and that's fine. But I Kip, I don't know what you think, but I mean, I just hate to throw good money after bad.
I agree with you. I think that international days have come. But I would look strongly at, you know, getting another chassis and putting that box on it. You know, I know they get a lot of money for those things. And that even if you paid to get the vehicle painted and stuff, it would look like it's a new vehicle, you know.
You can evaluate that.
The back of the conversations that we've had about remount versus new, the upfitters, they don't make money on the chassis. You buy the chassis separate. They make money on the box.
Yeah.
Their impression was, if you can buy a new truck, it's always better than trying to remount something. That they recommend the remounts when something wrecks and it's a brand new box and it's going on the exact same chassis. I'll certainly look into it. That was the conversation as it was described to me.
Get another opinion.
Conway remounted.
The chassis, like the Ford that we currently have, it's a straight chassis, and that's what the same thing on the International. So I would believe, other than, you know, shimming it however they need to do to get proper wheel clearance, it should go right on there. But
will they drop like the you know, the others kind of?
Yeah. Whenever you get a chassis
the
with
chassis
the,
does that.
With
that.
Gotcha. Yeah.
Okay. Yep.
What's next, Zach?
Let's see. The Hernishan family of South Deerfield very graciously and generously donated a lightly used washer and dryer set.
Thank you.
For this building. So it still has manufacturer's warranty.
Wow, that's awesome.
Yeah, they got it and they're like, I don't like these at all. So we love them. They're great. They're very nice models that can do sanitation, that has a heater in it, so it brings the water up to the level at which it'll kill things. So now that we have that, it means that our crews don't have to bring their soiled uniforms home and intermingle it with their family and their clothes. So that was very generous.
Yep. Very nice.
Deerfield Public Works Superintendent Kevin Scarborough worked to spec the generator, and he's got one on a bid that's for, I guess it's a sister one to what's going into the town hall.
Yeah.
So, yeah, Kip's shaking his head.
I don't care.
But the idea being that commonality across it, same maintenance, same equipment or whatever. So they came out and did a site visit. They said all the hookups, all the pads, all that that DA did looks like it's exactly okay. So
how far are we along on that? I know we put some money up for that, but I haven't heard anything.
The price on the town level was something like $60,000.
It was a lot.
Ridiculous. And I can't imagine you have that much money. Power needs here or...
Oh, no. Mine is like an $8,000. Right, yeah. Like, yeah. Oh, yeah. No, it's...
There's
it's,
some other thing that the town's cost.
Yeah, I don't... So, it was... Well, it was certainly competitive and comparable.
DA's electrician is going to install it.
That's fantastic.
Right? Yeah.
Did you look at all at putting solar panels?
Yeah, we positioned it.
I don't know if they're...
The building got built in the wrong direction.
Yeah.
No kidding.
We had the guy from Lake Street Development was going to do the solar for free.
What? I mean, we can...
On the roof, yeah.
We don't need to stick it on the roof if you...
No,
if we
got well, no, but then it was... The mounting thing was more than they were willing to do.
Yep.
And anticipation of the weather turning, we've been washing the trucks outside in the nice weather, but we've got... the vinyl sheets that are in the bay now around the slop sink or whatever, we're gonna do that around on the inside of the building so that, because we're worried about the water and the salt being sprayed off and ruining the drywall. So that's gonna be coming in, and then once that's in, we'll be able to finish with our shelving and stuff like that for all the equipment that's on the floor right now. We didn't wanna get those things bolted or settled down until that was done.
Have you thought about what you were going to get for that yet, or have you guys looked at anything?
The short answer is yes, the long answer is no.
It's a little complicated.
Yeah, so we need to, there's some depth and clearance, you know, on some of those walls that we need to take into account. Gary Stone has some shelves that he has available. So they're nice shelves. They're very deep. So it's just a question of measuring them and making sure that they're going to fit. I'm going to yell out to everybody in TV land that if you have metal lockers, storage, and especially like wide lockers for staff uniforms and jackets and personal protective equipment, that would be free to a good home to reach out to me. And we can certainly coordinate removal and transportation if that's an issue. But those things, I mean, just the lockers alone are prohibitively expensive to buy brand new. And, you know, so those are exactly the type of thing that people are like, I just want to get rid of this if somebody would just come and get it. So if anybody has any, let me know. And then the final thing in my report is, there's this one incident, one person in particular who's reached out to us, a BOO member again recently. Their family has an employer self-funded health plan. So they carry like Partners or Blue Cross Blue Shield or whatever insurance card, but it's through the employer, and it's actually the employer that cuts the check and pays the insurance on the back end. They've required emergency medical services numerous times recently for a sick member of their family, and their insurance company, their employer, is fighting it, is refusing to pay it on the grounds that they didn't choose an in-network ambulance service when they had an emergency. That they called 911, they got whoever they got, and it was their fault for not getting somebody else. So I've been working very diligently with the family as ComStar to try to figure out exactly where the miscommunication is, where is the breakdown. The family, the patient, is not on the hook for anything. They have a commitment from us and ComStar that no actions are going to be taken. We're not expecting them to pay this bill. It's not going to go collections or anything like that. We do believe this is a misunderstanding with their insurance company. And I've been working with the president of ComStar, actually, and she said, quote, never in her 18 years has she ever encountered anything like this, that there's there's
def- familiar. I don't know. Did we have a situation like this?
This goes back to November.
Same one.
Same, yeah.
Same one. So still ongoing. The family member reapproached a BOO member recently. Yeah. So it's come back up. I've spoken to that family member personally just the other day. And I think, you know, it's unfortunate. It's very difficult. They're dealing with a very sick family member, and to have this kind of added on to it is bringing a lot of stress.
I might be out of line here, but why shouldn't the conversations be with the insurance company? And as to, you know, why isn't somebody who needs help supposed to go through paperwork? And
right,
are you an in network ambulance service?
So we're like, we
that's
can't
crazy.
it's funky. We're not allowed to advocate for the patient, so it has to the a lot of these communications have to be like go through the family or go through HR. Their HR representative is supposed to call me any day now and tell me exactly. They've asked us for certain letters, certain language, certain proofs, and we've supplied them all along the way. We truly believe it is a misunderstanding because they're self-insured about how the system, you know, is supposed to work. The Affordable Care Act, I'll mention it again, actually prohibits legally this thing from happening, but there is an exception carved out in that law for self-insured employer healthcare. So.
Of course,
yeah. So there's no legal recourse, but we've never seen it actually happen. So we're working.
Is it a large dollar amount?
No. We've transported numerous times.
Yeah. So the
family wouldn't, under our policy, qualify for abatement.
Yep.
Because of their income.
Yep.
But we are
need it, right? They should be able.
Yeah, exactly. Right. And they are not on the hook for this month. We believe that we can
eventually it'll work this
with
out.
The insurance company. We can come to an acceptable conclusion. To
is
everything.
There any way of getting help from the state?
That's a great question.
I
mean, like an advocate or something for the patient.
Well, either that or somebody
like.
Somebody to say that violates state law. So
yeah.
A rep.
What would you do if you had to emergency air transport?
The presumption is you don't have choice in the market in an emergency.
A $20,000 ambulance ride on a helicopter.
And that's why the Affordable Care Act says you will treat these as in-network, covered by insurance. You have a $50 copay, that's the only bill you're going to see because you can't shop around when you call 911.
Yeah, exactly. Absolutely.
And that's why in her 18 years, she's never experienced somebody stonewalling and asking for the things that they're asking for. Huh. So... we're working diligently. We care about our community. We're not going to hang anybody out to dry or anything like that. So
the people from ComStar are they're the ones who are trying to straighten out the bill.
Mm-hmm. ComStar us, yeah. ComStar has been working very, very hard and very well. Really being legally, they can't be an advocate for the patient, right. But they are advocating for this patient very hard.
Isn't there an insurance commissioner?
Yeah, with the state or whatever. Yeah. I don't know.
He needs to call them and say, hey.
Oh, get a hold of a rep.
Yeah.
And you know, I suppose you can, I don't know who the insurer is, but, you know, someplace along the way, if the state started to threaten them to take away their right to sell insurance in Massachusetts.
Yeah. It's the company is self-insured, mm-hmm. basically, and it's they're headquartered out of state, so I think you know that's kind of complicating things too. But you're absolutely right. I mean, it's why are you?
You had
a dedicated employee for you know how many decades, you know, who's been buying insurance for how long, and now all of a sudden they needed it, and you're stonewalling it. And that concludes that for my director's report. Tom wanted to discuss, you know, our policies and our procedures when we experience like an equipment failure or malfunction in the field or something. So I don't know if we want to drag or talk about something else until he's back in the room.
Well, you can finish that conversation. Tell him he should have been here.
He took a phone call. I'm sure it was important if he stepped out for it. I don't know. A new conference table.
Here's Tom. Oh, there he is. We're just talking about you.
Oh, we just finished.
Good.
When we go on a call,
and then the ambulance breaks down.
Yes.
What's our policy or protocol?
Yeah. Answer it.
So, the policy is that whatever services that that vehicle or that ambulance is bringing to the patient, immediately a new source for that needs to be discovered.
I got a question.
Yeah.
I heard of a thing where we sent one ambulance out, then that had a failure, then we sent another ambulance out that couldn't make it there. So, we end up, there's Northampton or somebody else had the mutual aid, they went there. But my question is, now we have four EMTs that are sitting in broke vehicles. Mm-hmm. I would think our priority would be getting at least one of them to that house or that residence or wherever ASAP. Yeah. So why wouldn't we have called the Deerfield Police or Sunderland Police or Whiteley Police, wherever we were, to get the paramedic in the front seat, not the back seat, and get him?
Yeah, you're absolutely right.
And even if it meant Deerfield going to Sunderland or Whiteley, nobody in Deerfield would complain. Just like if the ambulance got stopped in Sunderland, we wouldn't complain if one of our cops had to take somebody to Conway.
Right.
So why wouldn't we do that? Because to me, having four EMTs sitting down in a broke vehicle is ridiculous.
So in that,
and it makes us look stupid.
In that specific instance, we only I'm using it as an example.
We can make excuses. I want to know, Zach, what are we going to do to make that never happen again?
Can we give an explanation of what happened? Because
it was a weekend. We didn't have an impact shift person on, and I wasn't on duty.
Okay.
Two people responded in an ambulance, and it broke down on the way.
Okay.
It was on the Whateley-Hatfield line. They immediately notified dispatch, and they immediately dispatched another ambulance. Northampton was available. They responded immediately.
Okay.
They were close enough. They were almost done with their response, but far enough that they couldn't throw things on their back and walk in, which would be the first option.
Right.
The second option would be to call, if we had an impact shift person or additional crew, you respond with another ambulance, you grab somebody in, and you go in and you leave somebody with the truck.
Yeah.
The third would be have the Whateley officer come and grab them since it was in Whateley, but they were on scene rendering aid. So then, sure. I mean, down the list, sure.
You could
reach out to another fire department, the police department, something like that.
Yeah.
I can't speak to a universal policy that will.
We could make a policy.
Always beyond whatever the situation calls for. Making the ambulance weighs 8 tons. Because it has that much gear on it. To say that we can dispatch a police car and we're gonna unload everything that we might possibly need
Zach, sometimes when a person calls an ambulance, they wanna know, they wanna have someone respond. Even if you take your go bag and you take your go bag with you and you go there, you are at a disadvantage because you don't have everything, but you know what? That person, that family, the group sees a paramedic come there, and you can say, look, I'm limited right now, but can I see, is a person, you don't know, is a person bleeding, is the person hyperventilating, does it need but you're there.
And responder is basically what you're
there. And seeing somebody that comes in that has South County EMS on their shoulder matters to people. And I'm saying if you got two EMTs, highly paid, highly trained, and they're sitting in an ambulance that's not working, and that to me is something that we shouldn't allow, that we should have a policy. Hey, look, we need to get, and I don't want the ambulance left there. So I want one person person in the jump seat. Yeah. I want that person to get there and say, Mr. Look, we're here. We got people coming. They're going to be here, and I'm here to,
And
that's what you guys do.
Right. Let me ask you a question, Tom. So that would, what you're thinking and envisioning is, so we break down on the road. We would still obviously dispatch another ambulance.
Absolutely.
Right.
But even still, get picked up and at least show up there, even though the other ones are coming. Because you can get there first anyways, even with
for me,
we're there to touch that.
I've seen it, I personally seen it, when you have an EMT come, the whole thing is de-escalated.
Calms down.
Or, you know, and you see a medical person come on board, it de-escalates the whole thing. And look, we've probably all been, at some point in our life, we've waited for a police, we've waited for fire, we've waited for ambulance. It can be 1 minute. That 1 minute is the longest minute in your life.
Yeah.
The other ambulance, if you're dispatching a second ambulance, does that require more than one person on that?
Well, it would come from...
If it were coming from here.
You need two providers. So if it was coming from here, you could send one person on the way. You grab somebody and that there's your group. Yeah. In that instance, the closest available next ambulance was Northampton. So they just came with their crew.
They've got their own staff.
You would just respond with one person and make up your crew that way. Sure. My apologies for coming across as defensive initially. That was an unfortunate situation, highly unusual. You're absolutely right. I mean, to have a policy that says, you know, like all attempts will be made to secure the vehicle and continue your response or whatever.
But you have please understand one thing, Zach. It's not criticism, but it's. We expect a high level of service. We've come to, and your success has driven our expectations, mm-hmm. Okay? And that's what I'm saying. I just know what it's like to wait. Mm-hmm. And if you have someone there and it happens once a year, it's important to that one person. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Right. You know what I'm trying to say?
Absolutely.
But you're the reason, your team is the reason that we expect a high level of service. So it's not a criticism, it's a compliment, sort of.
If you get, let's just make something up. So this happens in Sunderland.
Yeah.
How many police officers, is your police officer a first responder?
Yes, all police officers must be certified.
So you may end up having this police officer on the scene, and I assume at that point you only have one person on duty in Sunderland much of the time.
Well, in this particular instance, that's basically what happened. The officer was already on scene and rendering aid and that type of thing. So then you would call somebody out. You would dispatch the fire department or a neighboring police department or somebody like that. Yeah.
If I'm not mistaken, I think Tom's whole point here is just to have a plan.
Yeah.
So we're not just sitting there twiddling our thumbs.
Yeah. And letting
to have a plan so we know
somebody
if the breakdown happens and then you got plan A, B, C, and we know.
Right.
Do your due diligence.
I just know how people feel when they feel like they're and it's a terrible feeling. And we've all been there.
And this, even if the other ambulance gets there before you do, at least South County showed up and
all right.
Okay.
Do we need to mention the lease agreement?
I know it's not on the agenda, but I thought we had dealt with this already.
We didn't.
I noticed we haven't paid rent yet.
This one.
So.
And we're not going to pay rent.
Yeah.
Again, money,
money,
Dick Trevor. Landlord.
Do you want to give us a rough overview of it?
There's a lot of stuff that is really just routine lease agreement stuff, but the gist of it is exactly as we spoke about a year or so ago. The rent is fixed pretty much forever at $3,000 a month. It describes in the lease that, you know, the town of Deerfield will do the maintenance and, you know, plow the yard and do those things like that. Any repairs that need to be done for the building, they'll do that. And one of the things that I like about this is being involved with the town, the limited number of years I have, you know, every time that there's a major expense, it's always seems to be you got to go to the finance committee, you got to, you know, put an article on the town meeting. This way the money will be kept aside so if we need a new roof in 20 years, you know, the Board of Selectmen say, all right, go ahead.
You still need to go through the procedure. I don't care how you do it.
But the money will be...
The money is someplace.
The money is some... So the money's already there. But then it's just procedural then, of...
Yeah, you can't spend it unless you get town meeting or approval.
Really? Because that's not what Lisa said. If it was kept in in a fund, I don't know.
Like a revolving fund.
Revolving fund, whatever. If it's dedicated for the building maintenance for that, then it could be used for that without...
We have a town building fund, but
yeah. I don't know
what it's called.
You're both right, I think. I think you'd still have you'd set up a revolving account for this building, but then you would, so the money could only be used for this money, but you'd still need town meeting vote to say that you could use the money.
Gotcha.
Right. It's like member one is just trying to save money for fire truck or ambulance.
So I think you're both right.
It's only earmarked. You still got to vote it out of the...
Gotcha. That makes sense.
Yeah, I think you're both right.
In faith, and we're putting away X
and it's dollars. It's more complicated if the money were to stay with South County EMS, because that's even more complicated. So if you pull it out, put it into a...
I don't want that headache.
I see what you mean.
And the idea is anything outside of the walls, the snow removal, the landscaping, anything intrinsic to the building, so the furnace, stuff like that, it's a town-owned building, so the town would be responsible for that. And then day-to-day operational stuff, responsibility of keeping it clean, things like that is all on the department, which seems totally reasonable and appropriate as far as I'm concerned.
And one of the things that I like about this thinking going forward is that even if, you know, it's a boiler thing, you know, we can just hire, you know, any plumber to come in and do it, and the money's there.
Yes.
You know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Even if worse comes to worse, you don't have the money allocated. You know, you can't let buildings sit here without repairing a boiler.
Right.
Just ask Amber.
It's an investment in the service. That's fine. Yeah. I like that idea. If it's just an investment in the service.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm going to have to send that to council
for review. Please do.
Well, I can tell you some of the stuff that I've seen come through ours. I see it, and they don't make the changes they're supposed to. And
yeah, it's been rounded around.
You know, they put wrong dates, wrong addresses, like and stuff, and I'm like, what is this?
They read it 5 minutes before they sent it back.
Oh, man. It's so confusing. From two different lawyers, you're like,
yeah. I don't know.
We said change that word 10 times. Still didn't get done.
Yeah. All right.
You all set?
We're going to bring this back next month and vote on it, or no? That's we don't vote on it because that's your
lease.
So it's really the town of Deerfield. From the town of Deerfield,
we don't have to out there.
So did we settle a thing about the payment and the thing of the insurance stuff?
Yes. The quick version
is work in progress. It's not going away.
The family is not being held responsible or expected to fix it. You've got a question?
Does the family know that?
Yes, explicitly. Repeatedly, I've communicated.
I think I believe that someone in that chain is not living up to their, not the family, that they're, that
no, it's obvious,
is not living up to their responsibility.
That is obvious, yes.
But at the same time, I don't ever want any person in our three towns not to call the ambulance. They can't pay for it.
Absolutely.
And I don't. Right? I mean, that's not why we're in our business.
I personally spoke to that family on numerous occasions. They have a commitment from South County EMS and from ComStar that no action's going to be taken from them, that we consider this a miscommunication or something going on with the insurance company. And they are dealing with some very significantly stressful times. And
can
I
you
think
just make sure that no, if it arises again, that no person ever feels...
Yeah,
if they need to, can you reach out to the representative from that town and fill that representative in so that rep from that town and you can talk to the people directly.
Yeah.
I just think it's just so, it pains me to think that somebody wouldn't call us.
Yes, this first came up back in November.
Yeah.
Starting in November is when it happened. The families called us numerous times. I think, you know, they get a statement from their insurance company and it bubbles back up their frustration.
Jonathan's up to speed on it and he's...
He and I talked tonight before, and that's still a concern. And I just want to make sure that...
The families understand them.
They're responsible. They're very responsible.
Yeah.
It appears, you know, they don't...
Right. Oh, yes. Yeah.
Okay.
And that's, yeah.
Okay, the date of next month's meeting.
It's my favorite part.
Thursdays, you guys got a problem with the last couple of months?
What are we? Oh, it's October?
We got a meeting every night anyway. 18th.
October already?
18th
is Western Mass EMS Conference.
Do we need an October 25th. Meeting or do you want to go to November?
Fine with me, huh?
November's fine.
November's fine with me.
Unless there's something that comes up, I mean, I'd meet, but if there's...
Third Thursday in November, that's like Thanksgiving or something.
It's the 15th.
Well, we can have a big turkey.
The third is cooking. Thanksgiving is the fourth Thursday.
Before Thanksgiving. There you go.
The 15th of November.
Yeah.
Let's do that. 6 o'clock.
Entertain a motion.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.